Viewers on Facebook and Zoom, thank you for joining us in today's session. We have with us Dr. Meenakshi, currently the Assistant Professor in the Department of Yoga at Central University of Rajasthan. She will be sharing on symptom burden and quality of life impairment in head and neck cancer patients undergoing radiotherapy and its relationship with perceptions of yoga intervention. Let us all give Dr. Meenakshi a very warm welcome. Please, Doctor.
Thank you, Peru, for introducing me to all my listeners. Thank you all for joining today's lecture, or you can say. So what today I'm going to share is about a study that I did with head and neck cancer patients. And it is titled as Symptom Burden and Quality of Life Impairment in Head and Neck Cancer Patients Undergoing Radiotherapy and Its Relationship with Perceptions of Yoga Intervention. So as we all know, cancer is basically a disorder in which there is hyperproliferation of the cells. There is uncontrolled hyperproliferation, uncontrolled proliferation, and reduced apoptosis. So we know apoptosis means there is something called as programmed cell death in our body. There are different types of cells and each cell has to die within a certain period of time and new cell regenerates. So this process of regeneration and degeneration of cell gets reduced. And there is more of regeneration, formation of cells as compared to the degeneration of cells. So that is why the tumor cells keep on growing because the death is not happening. So epithelial carcinomas of the head and neck arise basically from the mucosal surfaces in the head and neck area. So what all cancers are included in this? It includes paranasal sinuses, cancer of oral cavity, cancer of nasopharynx, oropharynx, hypopharynx, cancer of tongue, salivary glands, larynx, and even the cancer of thyroid. So all these are together called as the head and neck cancers, and majority of the head and neck cancers are of squamous cell type. There are different varieties of cell types like squamous, columnar, cuboidal. There are different varieties. So of these, head and neck cancers are of, majority of these are of squamous cell type. And the most common cause of head and neck cancers is linked to tobacco and alcohol use basically. So alcohol, if taken individually, does not induce head and neck cancer as much as when it is taken along with tobacco. So tobacco along with alcohol together are linked to the cause of head and neck cancer. Apart from these factors, and human papilloma virus is one of the major factors which leads to the development of head and neck cancer, particularly oral cancer. And how this human papilloma virus cancer happens, it is because of the basically oral sex. Apart from this, infection can be one of the cause, like Epstein-Barr virus, EBV virus infection can lead to the head and neck cancer. So almost 10 million people every year die from cancer. And in 2017, it was seen that 9.56 million people died prematurely as a result of cancer. You can see the whole prevalence. You can see the esophageal cancer, more than 4 lakh, 4,35,000 deaths happened due to esophageal cancer in 2017. It was the seventh most common cause for death due to cancers. And after that comes at the 13th place, lip and oral cavity cancer, followed by larynx cancer and nasopharynx cancer. 4.5% of all the cancers worldwide is attributable to HPV, human papilloma virus cancer. Of these, 8.6% are women and 0.8% are in men. So in the head and neck cancer, HPV attributable cancers represent 38,000 cases, of which 21,000 are oropharyngeal cancers occurring in more developed countries. And it was already predicted by WHO that the cancer cases will increase till 2020, and it will reach to 12 million by that time. So this slide is very important because though this study was done in United Kingdom, but it shows a wide spectrum of cancers with different causative factors. So overall, you can see that if I show here this arrow, it shows oral cancer and what are the different causes: tobacco, low fruit and vegetable intake. It was seen, a research was conducted, and it was seen that oral cancer or head and neck cancers are commonly seen in those people who take less fruits and vegetables. So now the study which I conducted, the basic research question behind that was, does the perceptions about yoga in head and neck cancer patients have any correlation or influence on their symptom burden and quality of life? We just wanted to see whether if a person thinks, the way a person perceives yoga, his way of thinking, does it influence his symptom burden and quality of life? So the study was conducted in the leading oncology center of India, Healthcare Global Enterprise Limited, HCG, Bangalore. It is in South India. And the total subjects that were recruited were around 53. So selection criteria was those patients who were diagnosed with head and neck cancer, those who were undergoing conventional treatment. Conventional treatment means the chemotherapy and radiotherapy. And both male and female subjects were included with age group between 25 to 80 years. And those who were diagnosed with psychiatric illness and who were unwilling to participate, they were not included in the study. So we took the ethical clearance and took proper consent from the patients, from the subjects, before including into the study. And this study was basically one-time survey study. So assessments that were done were to measure symptom severity and symptom burden. And the questionnaire that was used was MD Anderson Symptom Inventory. And to assess the quality of life impairment in head and neck cancer patients, there is a specific questionnaire available. European Organization for Research and Treatment in Cancer, Head and Neck 35 questionnaire. It is also called as EORTC, HNN 35 questionnaire. And to know about the perceptions of the patients towards yoga, we developed a yoga perceptions checklist. It included a variety of questions regarding the perceptions of patients, how they perceive yoga, how they perceive benefits of conventional treatment, as well as we had some questions related to the safety and efficacy issues of yoga. So coming to the results, when we did statistical analysis, we saw that when we correlated the perceptions of yoga of head and neck cancer patients with their symptom burden and quality of life, we saw there was not much relation between these two, perceptions as well as quality of life and symptoms. Then what we did, we divided these subjects into two groups. There were some subjects who were already doing yoga, and there were many of them who were not doing yoga. So we divided it into two groups, and then we saw whether this symptom burden and quality of life, whether there is some difference between the two groups, those who are already doing yoga and those who are not doing yoga. So what we saw, that the psychological distress in the yoga group was significantly lower as compared to those who were not doing yoga, which is very commonly seen put forth by many other research studies, which shows that yoga reduces the psychological distress. So the same thing came forth from our study also. In other things like, say, this quality of life and head and neck, this symptom burden, we saw that the patients who were already practicing yoga, the scores were lower, showing the lower trends as compared to the patients who were not doing yoga. However, we did not reach the statistical significance. So yes, quality of life, symptom severity and symptom distress did not show any differences. However, there were trend for lower scores among the yoga practitioners as compared to the non-yoga practitioners. Now, perceived benefit of yoga and conventional treatment. This is one of the important results or assessment that we did. We saw that the perceived benefit of yoga among the yoga practitioners was around 67%, 66 to 67%, and on the other hand, the perceived benefit of conventional treatment among non-yoga practitioners was only 23%. So we'll come to the when I talk about conclusion, I'll just explain what is the importance of this. Just see what they saw, that perceived benefit of yoga among the yoga practitioners was 66%, whereas on the other hand, among the non-yoga practitioners, the perceived benefit of conventional treatment was only 23%, which shows that yoga actually enhances the positivity, brings about the hope in the person, reduces the hopelessness and helplessness in hopelessness in the person. This hopelessness and helplessness, actually, these are the two psychological factors which have been in many research studies have shown that hopelessness and helplessness are those psychological factors which are associated with the progression of cancer and many times development of cancer. So with this, we can also say that if yoga enhances the perceived benefits of conventional treatment or yoga, it can help in developing the positivity, developing the hope in the person, and thereby reducing or slowing down the progression of the cancer. So along with this, there were some from the yoga perception questionnaire we had developed. We saw the most common perceptions of head and neck cancer patients about conventional treatment. We just inferred from there, we did some statistical analysis, and from that we came to know that the most common perceptions were that conventional medicine, most of the head and neck cancer patients, they thought that conventional medicine is useful and it works. And second common perception was conventional medicine is too expensive. And very few thought that they were disappointed with the outcome of the conventional medicine, but they have no choice. And it is quite common those who had this recurrent head and neck cancer, means those who had already undergone conventional treatment and they did not get relief from that. Then the neck cancer patients about yoga. So the most common perceptions of these patients about yoga were, most of them thought that yoga is a training in awareness and relaxation. And yoga also involves twisting and turning the body. Yoga is a form of physical exercise only. So many of them thought that yoga is just limited to asanas. Many of them thought like that. So perceived benefits of yoga were, most of them thought that yoga reduces symptom distress, yoga improves quality of life, yoga improves sleep, yoga helps to calm down the mind. And very few of them felt that they did not have much information about yoga, so they cannot decide upon whether yoga is useful or not. So in the end, we concluded that yoga perceptions do not have any relation to the quality of life and symptom burden in head and neck cancer patients. So therefore, just thinking that yoga is good for health and is not enough. Actually, the practices of yoga is more important. Another reason behind such result would be that our study was not much powered. If the participants would have been more, maybe we would have got better results. So we can just look for some interventional studies in the future and then come out to some strong conclusion about this. Also, yoga practitioners experience less psychological distress. We got a statistically significant result and as compared to the non-yoga practitioners. Perceived benefits are higher among yoga practitioners. Means how they perceive whether yoga is useful or not, it was much higher in the yoga practitioners. Whereas those who were not doing yoga, they did not show this kind of positive attitude. Yoga also reinforced beliefs in conventional treatment and removed the negativity regarding the side effects. This may probably be useful in improving the compliance to the conventional treatment, which is very, very important. Therefore, adding yoga to the conventional treatment can prove to be an important and useful adjunct. So these are all the conclusions that we inferred from our whole study. What are the strengths and limitations? So this was the strength was that this was the first study to elicit the association between yoga perceptions and symptom burden, quality of life in head and neck cancer patients. Whereas limitation was the sample size was not much adequate. Our study was not much powered. So maybe future studies can be done in this direction with more number of subjects. And also, I would also recommend that similar type of studies. Say an experimental study in which some intervention is given for a certain duration of time and a particular module should be given, because here what happened that those participants who were doing yoga, they came to know about yoga from some sources, and they were including the yoga practices not as a whole. Some of them used a pranayama, some of them used only meditation. One or two components of yoga were done, and for different durations of time. It depended upon their time availability. It was not as monitored. So future studies, we can do some interventional studies where a specific module given for specific period time can be given just monitor this systematically. Thank you. So I can take your questions now.
Thank you, Doctor, for your valuable sharing. Now we'll open the floor for questions. Okay, we have a question from Winda. Winda, can you unmute yourself and you can ask your questions?
Hi, Doctor. Thank you for your presentation. Hello. Very scientific approach. I was just wondering, at which stage of cancer are yoga interventions most useful?
See, yoga intervention is useful in all the stages, I must tell you. Because yoga is something that is, we are not using it completely for curative purpose, but we can use it for reducing the symptom burden, we can use it for prevention. So we can use yoga practice in all the stages, because when a person is in cancer, stage one, stage two, it is easy for them to, they can be cured very easily by the conventional treatment. What we need to remember is in cancer patients, the complications because of these treatments is a lot, and they go through symptom distress as well as psychological distress. Okay, so to relieve those symptoms, yoga can be useful in all the stages. You can give yoga in stage one, stage two, stage three, stage four. Yoga can be given in any stages. And it has proven to be useful. There are n number of researchers, if you see, so many researchers in breast cancer, so many researchers in thyroid cancer, so many researchers in most of the studies are available in breast cancer. It has been shown that yoga practice improves the quality of life of cancer patients. It reduces the pain. It reduces the symptom burden in all these cancer patients. So you can give yoga to patients with who are in any stage one, two, three, four. But you have to design it. You need to see what kind of patient has come and what type of symptoms he has, whether he is able to do a particular practice or not. For example, if a person is having oral cancer, for example, so you cannot give him such a practice, or if a person is having, say, cancer of nasopharynx, so you cannot give him Nadi Shuddhi Pranayama. Okay, so you will have to design the practice based on the symptoms and based on the presentation of the patient. But you can give it to a patient of cancer patient of any stage.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Window. Thank you, Doctor. Kiran, do you have a question as well? I saw your hand raised.
Yes, I do. Hello, Dr. Meenakshi.
Hello.
My name is Kiran. Actually, one of my friend, she had thyroid gland enlargement, and recently she got it removed, and got to know that after removal there was a biopsy made, and yes, it was showing cancer cells. And being in her late 30s and early 40s, now she wanted to know what kind of yoga can support her.
Okay, so I must tell you that she can, does she have any other symptoms? Does she have any symptoms?
Symptoms
means any discomfort in the body, any discomfort in the body.
She underwent the surgery 2 weeks ago, and currently she's having, maybe they are actually lymph node might be affected is a question here. So she's
2 weeks back only. Okay, 2 weeks back, okay. So at present, how are her energy levels?
Quite good.
Okay. She is doing her routine work?
Yes.
Okay. So she's a housewife or she is working out?
Housewife.
Okay. So she is doing her routine work, no issues with that?
Yes.
Okay. So you can do one thing, that because she has underwent surgery recently and it is a thyroid gland cancer, no issues with that. Only thing is just avoid kriyas in the sense like all LSP and all that, because you need to, once you do lots of kriyas, what will happen that this energy levels, you feel tired. And immediately after surgery, you should not go for that. Just give more of pranayama. Nadi Shuddhi Pranayama is very useful for her. And do some stretching practices. In the beginning, give some stretching practices. Like start with Sukshmayam, loosening. Okay, Sukshmayam of small joints. And then see, depending upon her physical ability, whether she is able to do these structures. Don't do too much of stretching of this, like backward bending, because it will stretch her this portion. So it may affect, because the surgery has been done very recently. Okay, so do those practices which are not physically involving thyroid gland too much. Okay, like Jalandhar Band, Vagera, don't do such practices now itself. After some period of time, we can just think of doing these practices because they will help, but not immediately after the surgery. Okay, at present, most important thing in any cancer patient, I would suggest you should give pranayam practices. Okay, pranayama practices should be given, particularly Nadi Shuddhi Brahmari, because it is Nadi Shuddhi Pranayama particularly has been shown to reduce inflammation in the body, reduce the inflammatory cells in the body. Okay, and cancer in itself is a kind of inflammatory, it is a resultant of an inflammatory process. Okay, so it will help. Okay, so it will reduce the stress also, as well as it will help at the physiological level also. Give Brahmari Pranayama. All pranayama are useful, but don't give like too much of Bhastrika. Bhastrika should not be given immediately after this. Okay, or Kapalbhati practice. Give some mild practices in the beginning, and later on, depending on his physical strength, you can add on some practices, say asana. Or you can give asanas also, no issues with that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you, Kiran. Thank you, Doctor. We have one more question from Savita. Savita, please.
Yeah. Good evening, Dr. Meenakshi. This is Savita.
Good evening.
Yeah, Doctor, as such, like whatever research, like work you are doing, like I just want to know for a general public, rather, what we can do to avoid having the cancer. Because we are just hearing.
The best thing that you should.
Yeah.
I can give you the best answer for this. The best thing that you can do to avoid cancer is to follow a proper lifestyle and include yoga. That is the most important thing that you should do. The best, you should follow a good lifestyle. Okay. Lifestyle has four or five components. Okay. What are these four components basically? Good diet. Diet is one of the important components. Second is sleep. Okay. Third is physical activity. and fourth is stress. Now, when we talk about diet, take a sattvic diet. All these four components are the part of yoga therapy only, you might be knowing. Okay, so how I explain diet, take a sattvic diet. Sattvic diet basically includes, it's a yogic diet, means which includes more fruits and vegetables. And researchers have also shown that head and neck cancers are associated with those people who take low fruit and vegetables. Why? Because antioxidants are not given too much into the body, and oxidative stress is something that leads to the formation of cancer, not only head and neck cancer, but also other cancers. So sattvic diet include dairy products, include dairy products means milk, curds and all that, includes fruits and vegetables, fresh fruits and vegetables. This is one important thing. So sattvic diet is one recommendation. And second thing, I said sleep, take adequate sleep. That is important. Okay, and now the duration of sleep depends on from person to person, how much you are doing physical activity during the day. So generally, ideally, it is said that 6 to 8 hours sleep you should take. Third is physical activity. Now, physical activity in terms, I must say, yoga is a holistic way of living. So yoga is something that you should include in your whole routine. In the morning or in the night, in the evening, you should include asanas, pranayama. Do not think that only asanas are a part of yoga, because you are also, you belong to the community of yoga, so you already know. But I must tell you, I must emphasize this thing, that just thinking that yoga is asanas is not correct. If you want to say yoga, yoga is all inclusive. It is the holistic way of living. So it starts from the morning, the time when you start the day, and ends when you sleep. Okay, so the how you are living basically. But in general, if I shorten this, I must say include asanas, pranayama, dhyana, relaxation in your 1 hour yoga module, whatever you are practicing. Do all these practices. Give at least 15 minutes of relaxation, practice 15 minutes of relaxation, 15 minutes of pranayama, and then 30 minutes of asanas. And once in a week or once in 2 weeks, do some kriyas, which help in detoxification. So what I mean to say, and in the end, stress. What I mean by stress is that psychological stress is something that is the, one of the major causes for cancer. Again, one of the major causes for cancer. Okay, so cancer, this stress needs to be reduced. And one of the best practices to reduce stress is yoga. Is yoga, and what else to say about that? Or pranayama and dhyana, they lead to relaxation. They reduce the stress. So many studies are there, research studies are there, which show that yoga reduces the psychological distress. Even my research study, which I just presented, that also says the same thing. So all these four components, if you improve your lifestyle, if you make it better, person will never have cancer.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
One more thing I must tell you, that diseases can be genetic. Okay, but genetic diseases do not manifest unless and until the environment is favorable. So how we are going to prevent that wrong environment to influence our genes to manifest, wrong genes to manifest? By keeping our lifestyle better. So make your lifestyle better, and you'll be able to prevent not only cancer, but any disease.
Okay, thank you, doctor. I think it's time that we have to conclude this session. Thank you so much for your sharing. I think that we have all benefited from your sharing.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.